when Random House Audio presents. Every Night is Saturday Night, A Country Girl's Journey to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame by Wanda Jackson with Scott Bomar. Read for you by Gray Delisle. Forward written and read by Elvis Costello.
Forward by Elvis Costello. Legend has it that Pete Seeger was so horrified by Bob Dylan's electric set at the Newport Folk Festival of 1965 that he had to be restrained from cutting through the power cables with an axe. I have my doubts about this story, having seen a much older Seeger swinging a jackhammer at a railroad spike while singing a work song on the stage of Carnegie Hall. If it intended to stop the music, he could have done so easily. But here in the summer of 2011 was that same erect, still resolute frame standing just steps ahead of me in the wings of the Newport stage as that darn rock and roll music rolled out again into the afternoon. Did he look like he was about to do something rash and bring the music to a halt? Not a chance. I eased myself level with the great man and saw that he was beaming broadly at the sight and sound before him. Wanda Jackson leading her band from country ballad to rockabilly rave-up in a set that lit fire to a sunlit crowd. It was the music of American folk, as this is all American music. That it took a few years for Wanda Jackson to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame was a disgrace that once cast a shadow of credibility over that little boys' club. She's in there now where she belongs, having broken down a fair few doors along the way, and rolling out the red carpet for young women with guitars who may not even know her name. Within these covers, you'll read the names of many great American musicians, Wanda's teachers, friends, contemporaries, and acolytes, along with all the incidents, triumphs, and sorrows of her incredible career in music. The last time I sang with Wanda was on the stage of Kane's Ballroom in Tulsa, one of America's finest musical addresses. We gathered in the dressing room beforehand. "Just what I need in my life, another Elvis," said Wanda's gentleman husband, Wendell, repeating a joke that he'd cracked at our first meeting regarding people's enduring curiosity about his wife's earlier friendship with the King. We introduced Wanda to the kind of ovation that starts in Oklahoma and can be heard for states around before singing the Buck Owens hit, Crying Time. Wanda took her bow, flashed those green eyes in my direction mischievously. As she passed behind me into the shadows, I swear somebody pinched my cheek, and I don't mean the one below my eyes. She was just what we needed in our life, the one and only Wanda.
Preface. Big Daddy. Wanda? Oh, Wanda, are you tired? You need to wake up, honey. Daddy was insistent on getting my attention, but I was silently praying he'd leave me alone. I knew he wouldn't. This was the kind of thing Daddy never let slide. It was 1956, and we were in my Pontiac Star Chief, barreling down a two-lane highway between a town I can't remember and another one that's just as hazy in my mind. I was 18 years old, and had only been out on the road as a professional singer for a short time. Those days often run together in my memory as a blur of motels, dance halls, long stretches of blacktop, late-night diners, cheering crowds, friendly autograph seekers, and music, music, music. Daddy was my traveling companion, manager, chaperone, sounding board, guidance counselor, teacher, and in many ways, my best friend. He was also my protector, maybe my overprotector sometimes. Wanda, did you hear me? It looks like you're getting pretty tired there. Daddy was driving, and I was sitting next to him in the middle of the bench seat. On my right was a good-looking young singer who was headlining the tour. When we traveled from town to town, Daddy would let guys ride with us, but I couldn't go with him. I had my car, and that's the way I traveled. Daddy's rules. Sometimes I'd get sleepy, and my head would lean over onto the shoulder of the guy who was riding next to me. As soon as he saw it, Daddy would pull over and tell me to get in the back seat. If you're tired, he'd say, you can stretch out and get some good rest back there. Wanda! I knew I couldn't pretend any longer. What is it, Daddy? I tried to play innocent. Sweetie, I think it's time we pull over so you can get in the back. I'm sure Elvis doesn't need you leaning all over him. We want our passengers to be comfortable, don't we? Of course, it wasn't just that I was tired. This wasn't any old musician who decided to ride along to the next gig with us. This was Elvis Presley. Several months earlier, I'd never even heard of him, but now I really liked him. And not just his music. Every teenage girl liked his music, but I liked being around him. I liked the way he made me feel, and he liked me too. Soon after, he would give me his ring and ask me to be his girl. At that moment, though, there was no getting around Daddy's watchful eye. I couldn't put my head on someone's shoulder. I couldn't sit on a guy's lap. A lot of guys would want me to sit on their knee to take a picture after a show, but I couldn't do that either. Daddy was very quiet, but he was always watching. If he needed to intervene, he would. If I forgot the rules, I definitely heard about it later. It was important to him that I maintain a good reputation. I learned a lot from Daddy, and I realized today how important a good reputation is, even if I was pouting in that back seat after he banished me from Elvis's shoulder. I've always been a lady. That was instilled in me by both my parents from an early age. But they also taught me that it's good to be different. You don't want to be like everybody else, Daddy used to tell me as we traveled those long, lonely roads through countless dark nights from one show to another. We might be sharing the bill with Jerry Lee Lewis, Carl Perkins, Johnny Cash, Buddy Holly, or Elvis at an auditorium or dance hall somewhere in Texas, Missouri, Arkansas, or wherever the work took us. As a single young woman, still in my teens and just barely out of high school, there was certainly no way Daddy was going to send me out on the road alone with the boys. That's not the kind of thing a lady did in the mid-1950s. With Daddy by my side, I had a front row seat to the early rumblings of what was soon to erupt as a cultural phenomenon. I sang strictly country in the very beginning, which was known as hillbilly music at the time. Boy, that term always just upset me. I didn't like it. Elvis didn't either, but he was known as the hillbilly cat. Whatever you called it, our music was mixing with the blues to give birth to the early strains of what we now call rock and roll. Daddy and I both saw that something new was happening. We heard the screams of the girls that lifted the rafters with every movement of Elvis's hips. We saw the ecstasy on the faces of young people who were beginning to feel like they had a new kind of music they could call their very own. Though I'd started as a country singer, I soon joined the rock and roll party with Elvis's encouragement and made sure I was able to rock just as hard as the boys. In recent years, people have looked back on that era and started calling me the sweet lady with the nasty voice. I like to joke with people when they use that term and ask, "Whoever said I was sweet?" While my folks never failed to remind me to conduct myself with dignity and class in all situations, I didn't exactly fit the mold of the typical girl in the 1950s. Some people thought I was too strong. Others thought I was too wild. That never bothered me or my parents because I was taught that you can be different. You can break away and do some crazy stuff as long as you stay a lady about it. And that's exactly what I did. I was like a prim little lady, but fiery. I had a burning fire in my bones when it came to making music, and I could not be stopped. There are probably two Wanda Jacksons. Actually, there are at least two Wanda Jacksons. Some of my fans might be surprised to learn that offstage, I'm really a traditionalist. I'm a wife, mother, and grandmother, and recently became a great-grandmother, whose grandkids call her Ma. I never thought I'd be called Ma, but my first grandbaby couldn't say Grandma, so that's just how it came out. And it sure sounds awful sweet when they say it. I was married to the same man, Wendell Goodman, for more than 55 years, until he passed away in 2017. After we married, Wendell stepped in and took over the role my father had before him. He took care of the business, and frankly, I've always felt like I needed a good man to take care of me. I was never taught to have responsibility. Daddy handled everything, and then Wendell took it from there. Thanks to them, I actually could be the sweet little girl, nasty voice and all, who didn't have to fight her own battles. I would tell them my problems, and they took care of them. I let them be the bad cop and be perceived as hard to get along with, when it was usually really me all along. Because of them, I didn't have to worry about anything but the music. I've been well protected in that respect, and it has allowed me to successfully navigate my way through a long career without ever really butting heads with anyone. I've been asked if I'm a feminist, and I've been told I'm a hero to feminists, but I don't put myself in that category. People have always thought I was the woman who stood up against the man, but I was never that way. I understand that some women have to take a leadership role when their men won't, but women who just want to rule the roost and put men down so badly, that bothers me. I guess I just love and respect men. I don't want to fight them. I suppose I would if I got really mad or something, but I honestly prefer the company of men to women. Their conversations are much more interesting to me. At parties, I would always migrate over to listen to the men talk. Women would talk about their kids and their school and all that, but I didn't relate to it. The bottom line is I highly respect men, and I always depended on a man, whether it be Daddy or Wendell. And then there's another Wanda Jackson, the one the public knows. I probably never had as much self-confidence or self-esteem as people thought, but if you watch old videos of me performing, it's the absolute picture of confidence when I'm on stage. Once I got onto that stage, I was able to become something else entirely. I almost unconsciously flipped a switch. The stage is where I'm the queen. Always have been. I enjoyed shocking people a little bit, but that was the only place I'd do it. On the stage is where I sometimes made Daddy nervous with my sexy outfits and shaking hips. On the stage is where I would let out my trademark growl and express the raw power of music that lived deep in my soul. When I'm on stage, I hear everything the band is doing. I've always been good at that. During a show, I'll call the bass player over and say, "You're playing 4/4 time all the way through. I don't want that." Or I might tell the guitar player, "Hey, cut the volume down," or maybe "turn it up." And drummers? So many drummers rush the beat. It's hard to find a good drummer who will lock into the right tempo, but I push them to be their best. I control the stage. The stage has always been mine. People couldn't put purses or coats or drinks down on it. If some guy was sitting on my stage, I might just step on his hand. Or if people set things there, I might just kick them off. I can't do that anymore at my age, but I could get pretty feisty when protecting my domain in my younger years. The reason that stage is so important to me is because I know that everyone who comes to see me perform wants to have a good time, and that's what I want to give them. Every night that I entertain people and watch them have fun, it reminds me of being a young girl growing up in California when Mother and Daddy would take me to Western swing dances. I'd stare up at the stage at those musicians in their beautiful, sparkling outfits. I was mesmerized. I grew up thinking that music was happy and that it would always make me feel great. I associate music with fun and laughter and warm feelings. Going to those Saturday night dances with my folks was a wonderful time in my life. I didn't want Saturday night to end. I just had to figure out how I was going to live my life in a way that made that feeling last. Sometimes I chased the wrong things in that pursuit, but I never lost sight of throwing a party for my fans at every show.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.